So you can have a high vibration. For instance, you can even be a unicorn. The little room is a unicorn, fine. But does that mean that the little room may be acquired for 1 million plus, now 2.5 million plus, compared with the past implicit vibration of the last day of fidelity? This is the question. And merger and acquisition is a market as well. So you have supply and demand, you have macroeconomics, you have cycles and trends, you have mimic, and you have to be at a good place, at a good timing, and that may probably create a lot of opportunity. If you don't have a deal, you will not have a valuation or a price. It's just wishful thinking. So that's the reason why usually deals can be very long, even longer than we once forecasted, just because there's a window of opportunity with a pain point in the market, and the pain point may be covered not by the acquisition of a product, but the acquisition of a company, and you may be this company. So this opens a window, and then at some point the window closes. And if you don't have cash enough, if the entrepreneurs slash founders remain in the ambiguity of how to define success, if success is being big or a king, or having a high growth, or being very attractive in the eye of an employer, then we have difficulties imagining to be totally synchronized with the window at the M&A. So it comes to pedagogy, it comes back to the way that entrepreneurs maybe since the very beginning aware of the fact that the normal exit route is the normal result for them. Or not, that means a lifestyle or a lifetime company.
What kind of things that early stage founders can already start doing to maximize their options? What are the things that they should be doing maybe every week, every month, dedicate a bit of time?
I would say that they should take time once a week to say, how can I present myself? How can I present
myself? What do you mean? By
what
I'm doing? Suit? No?
Yeah.
You won't have a better suit than the maker.
What I'm doing, what I would like to achieve, why I'm confident that my growth is reliable, and why I would like to raise money, if you would like to raise money, or why I would like to find an industrial partner. You should take time to think about that, because what we are seeing is that in 100% of cases, people are not prepared to answer this question, which is not, I would say, an unstarter to start to work together. But if you think about that, the sooner the better. And then you need to always to have in mind what you would like to achieve in terms of value. 1 month ago, two funders wanted to sign a fundraising mandate with me because they would like to raise a 20 euro million series. And 2 days after that, they told me, well, we just received a phone call from a company in the US. I mean, that's the name, so you see. And they are proposing us 100 million to buy us. Okay. Say, well, what do you want me to do? They told me, we want you to do the
middleman.
The middleman, to try to find an agreement. And I found an agreement which was not 100 actually, which was lower than that, but which was more about 6, which is not nothing. And I told them, well, if I were in your shoes, that it's always difficult to give this advice because you don't run the company, you don't spend your hours running the business, so it's maybe more easy. But I told them, well, I would not accept this transaction. And they didn't, because we felt that this will not maximize the value expectations that are anticipating on a reasonable perspective.
So you're not managing the risk of the future of the business.
Yes, and it is up to you to say, well, I think that in the medium term, the value of my company will be there because I have this benchmark. Because you need to have conviction in order to be prepared to such approach.
2015, what kind of advice for founders, what can they do now? Like, I'm thinking particularly in terms of, so there's a story, you're ready to tell the story and explain the strategy, but how about the visibility or some other aspects of maybe what the company should do?
So maybe on strategy, I think we need to be very clear, we talked already on the 3 years strategy, that's one point. And then a key question I always ask, it's always funny to hear the answers, is who are your competitors? So quite often is, I'm the leader, €4 million of revenue, blah, blah, blah. So in fact, you need to know your ecosystem and who are your competitors and how you position yourself versus competitors and what are your selling points, unique selling points. So this is really a key question, so you need to be able to answer.
So the differentiation.
The differentiation, definitely. So this is really a key question for you when you meet some investor network or investors. So that is one point. And then you mentioned on visibility. So you need to agree on the business plan, of course, but and then the assumptions that go with it. And these assumptions need to be shared with the other team members. Because sometimes inside the management, when you meet two or three people from the management, you understand their misalignment.
They have different views.
The different views, and you feel it's fighting, and everybody has his own approach. So you need to have common alignment on where you want to go. That is also key for people.
And for that, I may advise you to write your deck together. Because it's by writing something that you will be sure that you share common view. And you will be prepared for it.
So all the founders get together to...
The founders get together,
the story together.
They write the story, they write the deck, and then they send it to an investment banker. And we will look at it for free, for sure. And we will tell you where we live in it, or where there is improvement, or where we don't feel comfortable with it. But you need to write it.
Okay. Well, any comments on other things on the agenda of CEOs?
Perhaps two things. Two technical things, very simple. First one is begin with the end. Begin by the end. So begin by drafting your press release that is announcing that in 2023 your company is acquired by Cisco or by Pfizer.
It's kind of a visualization exercise.
Absolutely, yeah. You put this, just in front of you. And once you have this, that makes you commit, that makes your first, team come as well, and you can do some kind of research engineering so that you may find out the critical path between 0 to 1. So that's a quite interesting vision that makes you easily define success on a day-to-day basis by being sure that this will be consistent with the big picture and the end of the exit story, which is by definition the exit route. The second thing, and that last thing from a technical point of view, is that if you have VCs or even business angels that are quite sophisticated or having a VCs, you may have signed a shareholders agreement. Just have a look at it. Just have a look at it. And contemplate what is written and what is the spirit of the language that is written here. You will probably see patterns about the equity story, the exit route, the milestones in terms of shareholders' vision, because this is the one document that makes the connection between the shareholders to make them committed and sharing the same vision during the equity story until the exit route. So the two things, the press release on one hand, the shareholders' agreement on the other, that will probably make you aware that it's quite difficult now to change direction, and you are, even though you were not aware of it, you are on the route to exit.
We're a bit over time, so I'll probably take one or two really short questions and get really short answers. Maybe just also, before we turn to questions, ask also one to you, which is, okay, what's your business? How do you, like, what's your business model? Because not everybody's familiar with that. So, do people pay you by the hour? Is it a retainer? Is it a transaction fee? What happens if suddenly, we're working with you for a trade sale and they decide to raise money with a VC? Like, what's going on? So, tell us more about the business side.
I will only speak for myself. Unfortunately, on this issue that I think quite at Rothschild, if we take mandate, we will be paid only if there is a transaction. So it is a success fee only. We will not ask you for retainer or money, or money for hours we will spend. No. We will be paid only if you take the money, and only if there is a company takes the money.
So how does it work? Half-half?
No. No, not all. So for fundraising activities, for example, we are taking a percentage which is in line with our competitors of the total amount which is raised.
Like typically,
it's a range between 3% and more than 6 to 7% depending on the complexity of the project and of the size of the
single. You will get a big size, you take small.
Yeah, for big size, we are able to make an effort to identify the numbers. And if this is an IPO, then we will have an advisory fee for the IPO depending on the size of the IPO, which is a percentage, again, smaller. And if we have an M&A team, if you want to sell your company, for example, to an industrial partner, or to merge your company with your competitors, then we will have an M&A advisory fee, again, which is paid only if there is a deal, which is a percentage of the transaction. And everything obviously is decided from the beginning.
Okay.
Sounds
pretty clear. It's quite
universal.
Okay. Holiday, any business model you guys have?
We have a full business model. On the pure transaction, we do what you just explained, so full success fee. So we can work like 9 months to develop to even more. Until the transaction takes place, and at this point, you will charge X percent of the amount raised in case of fundraising, X or Y percent of the total price for the trade itself. But we have also another business model which is connected to advisory for early stage company that we cannot afford to go through to because amount to be either sold or raised or too little to apply a success fee in terms of percentage. And then we have some limited fixed fee in order to go for this kind of transaction and pave the path to eventually a more ambitious trade sale or something.
I just realized like, I'm asking you how much it costs, but I think it's also clarifying that bankers have relationships, experience that can help you. As a founder, you come in and say, oh, I think I'm targeting that price. Then you discuss, you say whether that's realistic or not, because you can see it in the market. But in some cases, when you organize like a good, kind of not auction, but sort of like competitive bidding for the deal, you can actually like, double the price or even more and get much more than what's expected, in which case, the fee is like probably very happy to pay it.
Yeah.
Have you paid it regardless, but does that happen?
Yeah, like, it does. Sometimes if you see you have an incentive. It happens sometimes we have an incentive fee which may allow the bankers to obtain more amount of money to the company being sold at a higher price. And it is to align our interest between you and us. Because if we are incentivized to obtain more, we will be more happy.
People are like incentives.
Yeah, it happens sometimes. We have some clients that come with a term sheet of a large corporate, for instance, and we organize also competition, so it happens. But well, most cases are successful with P, so it's percentage of the amount of enterprise value. So that means that we really are interested somehow on the amount of transaction.
If you have VCs or CVCs in your equity, then pay attention to the clauses of your shareholders' agreement about taking the exit route. Because if you have a VC, there will be a pure VC. There will be probably commercial preferences. That is a mechanism that may eventually change the proportion of the exit price that will be allocated to you versus the portion that will be allocated to pure VCs. If you have corporate venture funds, there will be like a drag along or tag along clauses, and eventually the CVC may want at a certain point to act like more like a corporate, so with a strategic vision, compared with compared with the financial. So in corporate VC, you have VC with just about making money, capital gain, and you have corporate, which is just about making synergies and positioning of the big company that makes the acquisition. At a certain point, usually the only one is when the exit arrives. One CVC may do some kind of trade-off between the VC's way of tackling things versus the corporate way of tackling things. So be sure, make sure that your dragon may eventually force the CVC to sell, even though it's a trade sale to one of these companies, or to preempt the deal by making a superior offer.
I just realized it's quite classy all the time. So we're going to close the panel, unfortunately. So if you want to ask questions, are you guys sticking around for a bit? So you are, because you're speaking later. You as well?
Yeah.
Yes, fantastic. So we're going to move directly to the next session, take no break, because Eric can be accepted to participate, has to leave at 1:10, right? So let's thank our panelists.